Hello, welcome to MOOC lectures on strategy and introduction to game theory. In this module, I'm going to introduce a new concept, evolutionary game theory. Before we begin with evolutionary game theory, we should understand basic of evolutionary biology. What is the basic of evolutionary biology? The idea there is very simple, that genes, the genetic code present in all the animals are the prime determinants of their observable characteristics. This observable characteristics is called fitness. So, what do we say? More fit organism on average, typically they have better reproductive success. It means they produce more offspring, they produce more kids. Meaning that the genes which provide greater fitness get increased representation in the population. So, a particular gene, let us say that a particular gene represents a particular characteristics in the animal, and if it is, it has greater fitness, this will spread in the whole population of that animal. And the fundamental of evolutionary biology is that the notion of natural selection as the mode of evolution. So, what we have now? We have already discussed for 4 weeks regular game theory. Now, we are calling it regular game theory in the sense as opposed to evolutionary game theory. What happens in the regular game theory? We have players, and the players are rational. They rationally, they make decision. Not only they make decision rationally, but they make those decision consciously. And also the important thing is that they strategically they make decisions. So, there are three factors: players who make decisions rationally, consciously and strategically. Okay? As opposed to regular game theory, if we look at the evolutionary game theory, because it concerns with the evolution, what happens? The players there, and animals would be the players. Animals, a particular animal would not consciously or rationally or strategically would be making any decision. But what we say that game theoretic concepts would continue to apply even if no player is using any reasoning or making conscious decision. Of course, there the vehicle is of things are happening in a particular manner because players are interacting strategically, rational players are interacting rationally. Here what is happening? That the behavior is encoded in as a gene. Okay? And if a behavior leads to better outcome, then that gene would have better success in spreading in the whole population. So, that is the key. Fundamental question in the regular game theory is that how does a strategic interaction among the players decide the outcome of a game? Here, the fundamental question in evolutionary game theory would be which behavior will persist in a population. If a particular behavior leads to better fitness, notice that gene gets represented by behavior. Behavior can lead to better fitness. Better fitness means better reproductive success. So, if gene is having better reproductive success, then it will get spread out in the population. Here, natural selection replaces the rational behavior. Okay. So, coming back to again evolutionary game theory is that the key idea is that in a population, the success of an organism depends on how it interacts with other organism. Notice that when we started talking about game theory and also in the middle, we talked about two different scenarios in which a decision maker does not have to worry about the strategic consideration. There he gets guided by the parameters, like in a market when you buy an object, typically when you know you do not bargain and all, you know the price is fixed, in that case there is no strategic consideration. But whenever two players are interacting, okay, then strategy becomes important. What happens in the animal world? The animal interact with each other to grab food, to grab resources, to help them grow, to help them remain fit. Okay? So the interaction plays very, very important role. So although that interaction is no longer a strategic interaction, but nevertheless there is an interaction, and the role of the strategy would be played by genetic code that will be reflected in the a particular behavior. So in the animal world, it doesn't make sense to measure fitness of a particular individual organism or particular individual animal. What we are interested in is that we should measure fitness in the context of full population in which it lives. How does a particular animal do vis-a-vis other animals in the same population? That becomes important. So if we think evolutionary game theory is analogous to our regular game theory, what do we have? Who are the players? The living organism, animal, or living organism, animal, plant, they are the players. So organism. What are the strategies? Encoded behavior or characteristics. What is the payoff? Payoff is fitness. And this fitness should be evaluated in context of other players. So that would be in the game matrix. The payoff should be vis-a-vis when one animal interact with the other animal, what happens. Let us take one example to understand this concept. And this is a game that is being played in the beetle world. I have taken this example from a very popular book and very nice book, Networks, Crowds and Market, which is written by Easley and Kleinberg. This example is from chapter 7. You don't have to read the whole chapter. I have captured the essence here, and this is a beetle. I have given the picture of a beetle. So what we have? This beetle's fitness depends on finding and processing food effectively. Okay? Now let us say that all beetles are of the same size, of this size. Let us say this picture represents the size. And there is a mutation for some reason, some genetic reason. Now there are some beetles with the larger body size. Imagine a size twice bigger than, or 1.2 times bigger than this size. Of course, it is safe to assume that a large beetle will need on average more food in comparison to a regular or the small size beetle. So what should be the consequence of this mutation, this change, that now you have large beetle with larger size? What should be the consequence? One thing that one can think, that larger beetle will on average need more food. So their fitness would be less than a small beetle, and so that they would on average do worse than small beetles. So eventually they will be wiped out from the population. Why? Less fitness means they will be able to, their reproductive success would be worse than the normal beetle. So eventually their proportion would start decreasing in the whole population, and over the period through the evolution they will be wiped out from the whole population. But the question is it so? We will see. We will use game theoretic notion to understand that. And what we are saying, that a beetle typically competes with other beetles for food. Okay? It's not like the food, getting food depends on one beetle alone. So they compete with each other. So we are making some assumption now. A large beetle would get more food on average because of their larger size in comparison to a small beetle. Okay? Then we can say that if let us say that's true all the time, but if there is a competition between two beetles, and then if beetles are the of the same size, on average they will get equal share. They will be able to divide the whole resource in equal proportion. And if a beetle is large and other is small in the competition, then the large beetle gets the majority share, because we assume larger size would help in capturing larger resources. But we should not forget that a large beetle experiences less fitness in comparison to a small beetle for the same quantity of food. Why? To maintain that metabolic activity in the body, in the larger body, you need more food. So, if amount of food is the same, then the larger beetle would experience less fitness. So, here is the size game between two beetle, and these numbers are made up just to satisfy all the assumptions that we have made here. So, what we have, when a small beetle interact with the small beetle, they both get 6, 6. We can assume that size of resource is, let us say, 12, and they get half and half. When there is a large beetle and a small beetle, then there is a fight, some of it get lost, and so large beetle gets 10 and small beetle gets 1. And when two large beetle interact, lot gets lost in fight, and they both get 4 and 4. And also for the same amount of food, a large beetle would have less fitness, that would also decrease this number to 4 and 4 rather than to 6 and 6. So, you can justify it in 2-3 different ways. Now, what should you also notice, that I do not need to give the payoff of the second beetle. If I get rid of these second number, we have just here 6, 1, 10 and 4. What we do to get the payoff of the second beetle, the beetle number 2 here and beetle number 1 here, how can we get? We just transpose the matrix, we will get the payoff of the second beetle. Let us transpose it. 6 will be here, this 1 will come here, this 10 will go here, and this 4 will be here. So, exactly the same matrix we get. And here natural selection of course works over longer time scale. Now, what do we have? We are going to talk about a new notion, a new concept, a concept of evolutionary stable strategy. The idea is very simple. We cannot talk about Nash equilibrium anymore. Why? Because remember, what is the Nash equilibrium? That players are giving the best response, a player is giving the best response of all other players' strategy, and this is true for all the players. In other word also, a player would not like to deviate, player would not like to change his strategy given what other player are doing. And if this is true for all the player, then we say this is Nash equilibrium. Here, when we are talking about beetles, then of course beetles are not changing size. They cannot, simply this is not feasible that they would change size. So, it is not about deciding a strategy consciously or rationally, it is just hardwired. Okay? So, what is required here in the evolutionary biology? What is required? That a genetically determined characteristics and behavior, we have already given it a name, this is strategy, that becomes stable throughout the population. What do we mean by become stable? That if this strategy, if animal of this particular characteristics are present in the population, if the same animal with some other different characteristics get introduced, they do not have as, they are not as fit as the previous one. Then only we say that the previous one is the evolutionary stable ones. In other word, how the new type would get introduced? One process that is present in evolutionary biology is called mutation of some changes. So, this a change would not persist. If there is a change, it would eventually be wiped out if a particular characteristics is evolutionary stable. So, we are looking for now evolutionary stable strategies rather than looking for a Nash equilibrium. Okay?